This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good morning, good morning. To you. The birds. A chirping. Good morning.
You could try and take us, but with the gladiators, everyone a rager, but secretly the saviors. Glory and gore go hand in hand, that's why we're making headlines.
The eye-opener.
And I'ma get it, oh, I know what I'm doing. Patience and it's, I know what I'm doing, baby. Staring at a gladiator, talking about a revolution. No, this is not a game. No, baby. I'm talking turnout. I don't ever burn out. Well, I gotta make it turn out.
No, good morning, Bahamas. It is me. I'm all alone today. This is Alea, and you're listening to The Eye Opener, your daily dose or your weekly dose of something different. I'm so excited to be here with you guys and to talk with you. A couple of the co-hosts are running late, but they'll be with us shortly. We had a really, really chaotic, I want to say, week. I mean, a couple of these news stories are really killing me a little bit. I will not lie to you, but I'm really excited to hear everyone's opinions and to really go on and talk about that with you. We also have a wonderful and exciting show for you today with an interesting guest. So please feel free to call in. I kind of want to just jump right into it. There was a couple stories and a couple news articles this week that stood up to me a bit more than usual. We talked a lot about capital punishment, and that really had social media ablaze. I don't know how I'm feeling about it. There was a poll that was online on Twitter by one of the news stations here in the Bahamas, and the phrasing of it was kind of implying what would we like to have done to us. And so people had called them out for it, but a lot of people were torn on capital punishment, right? I mean, our history with capital punishment is really extensive, and it is violent, a bit more violent than I think people would like to admit. I remember growing up, my grandmother, who was born and raised in Eleuthera, shout out Eleuthera, right? And she would tell me about how people would be whipped with cat of nine tails, and then they would be made to swim in the ocean afterward, after being whipped, and how they would have public hangings and people would be hung. And so thinking about all these things, thinking about our history, I feel wary that this is where we're headed, right? I mean, I'm hoping that there are some people who could shed light on maybe the historical aspects of capital punishment in the Bahamas and how that would reflect on our society. I do wonder about not just the implications of having it, right? But what kind of society is that if we are genuinely excited for and if we genuinely desire capital punishment? Like, what does that say about us? And I don't really think that even the research is in favor of capital punishment. I'm personally not. I think that we should always focus on rehabilitation first and foremost. That is a huge thing for me. I know that a lot of people will think, well, how can you reform this? And I'm still of the opinion that in certain cases, how can you reform certain crimes? So I'm not there. Like, I will say my knowledge and my awareness and my activism for, like, let's say something as crazy or something people would think is crazy, like prison abolition, for example, where you completely remove the current prison model and you replace it with something that is more beneficial to society as a whole and something that focuses more on rehabilitation. So I struggle with that because you'll hear some really egregious, terrible things and you will immediately go to, like, okay, yes, like, this person, we need to hang them, or, you know, they need to be locked up. Right? Like, and I'm still there. I will not lie and say, like, I'm super progressive where I am immediately like, oh, this can be reformed. So that is something that I'm still working on. I'd love to hear a couple of the callers, your opinions on that, on crime, on wow. I mean, that is even a topic, right? Where the murder rate right now is ridiculous. We are, and so I guess that's where capital punishment is really coming in, right? Where we're trying to figure out how to mitigate this issue, but I genuinely feel vehemently that capital punishment is not going to solve the crime issue. I don't even need to be, I don't think you need to be pro punishment, pro hanging, pro whatever, to understand that that is, it's not going to work. We've tried it so much. Like, we've tried it so much, it's not going to work. And a lot of Bahamians, so I'm still in London, and a lot of Bahamians have been talking about over-policing recently because, of course, capital punishment, I feel, goes hand in hand with over-policing. We got these roadblocks. And I love that people keep choosing that Bay Street is the best place for this. I don't know. But anyway, I will say I think long-term solutions, so long-term things like wages increased, so increasing minimum wage, right? Stronger access to education and healthcare, a proper education system. I feel like all of these things in tandem, right? Those lead to a better society and a stronger society where Bahamians can feel comfortable in themselves, and they won't have to look to crime or look to dangerous activities in order to make a way or make a living. And I think those as well, like the overall happiness of, you know, people of the citizenry itself would go a long way in the reduction of crime. I am wholeheartedly in agreement with that. I think 100% that is something that I'm sure of. I will say, like, it just bothers me though that I, looking online, on the conversation, you'll see that there's a lot of people who think that, you know, if we do those, if we look for solutions, like actual solutions other than outside of the police and prison, that the Bahamas will be in shambles, right? Or that maybe, you know, these healthcare and education won't actually solve anything. But I mean, my God, like, surely there has to be something else, right? If we're looking for solutions, then I think we should try everything in our power before we talk about, you know, hurting criminals and doing things to people. So with that being said, I see that we have our wonderful other host here. Crystal is in the building. Hey, Crystal.
Hello, what's up? What's up?
Girl, I was fighting demons without y'all here. Demons. I love to hear y'all's voices in the morning.
You need some holy water, a prayer shawl, and the book, Prayers That Row Demons.
Girl, listen, we need to call in the saints. We need to call in the saints.
For real. You need just some little oil, just sprinkle that around.
Some herb.
Yeah, some herb. Yeah. So, thank you, Aaliyah, for holding it down. And today we are going to be talking a little bit more about crime. But before we get into that, we're going to recap on some of the top stories for this week. So on Monday, we had three more murders announcement coming from the police. A woman was the latest victim, and the killing spree that has gripped New Providence in recent weeks continued on the weekend, with a woman being shot dead in Baynetown last night and a man murdered in a double shooting in Pinewood Gardens. We also had the Prime Minister, Davis, traveling to Uganda this week. In this story, the Nassau Guardian by Travis Cartwright Carroll, Prime Minister Philip Brave Davis led a delegation to Uganda last Friday to attend the Non-Aligned Movement and Group of 77 South-South Cooperation in Multilateral Diplomacy. Minister of Immigration and National Insurance Alfred Sayers, Minister of Foreign Affairs Fred Mitchell, and Senior Police Advisor in the Office of the Prime Minister Jerome Fitzgerald were among those who traveled with Davis. On Tuesday, we had Enough is Enough. The Free National Movement leader, Michael Pintard, called on the Davis administration to act with urgency to address the country's crime crisis, saying that he has yet to see any short or long-term solutions put in place to address the issue. At a press conference outside OPM on West Bay Street, Pintard also criticized Davis for traveling to Uganda to attend a conference while the murder count was climbing. 17 people have been murdered since the start of the year, and this is obviously from Tuesday, so that number is now up to 19 today. And last week, the government released a five-pillar plan to fight crime, which includes measures like tougher legislation for gang activity and a focus on school policing. Ahead of the plan's release, Davis made a national address on crime, pledging tough action. Since the address, six more people were murdered. And as we know, it's been much more since then. On Wednesday, the Road Traffic Department, big news coming out of there, they are planning on relocating by next month. So they're currently housed at the Thomas A. Robinson National Stadium, and the staff has complained for years about the subpar working conditions. The Minister of Energy and Transport, JoBeth Colby-Davis, said in another month or so, the Road Traffic Department will be fully relocated. So the staff has complained, and she has promised for 2 years now to address those concerns. And they will be moving to they plan to move to the old entertainment complex on Tanique Williams-Darling Highway. There's quite a bit in the news. So in addition to that, on Thursday, the government pledges to amend the Bail Act. Prime Minister Philip Davis yesterday announced that his administration plans to amend the Bail Act, which would allow for bail to be automatically revoked for accused criminal who commit a new offense. The MPs also passed the Ombudsman Bill this week in the House. And the PM hopes for the sale of the Grand Lucayan in Grand Bahama this year. Prime Minister Philip Brave Davis said that he believes the government will sell Grand Lucayan Resort on Grand Bahama by the end of this year. And that is the news for today. One more story we have here, just an update, basically. Quaker, the company, issues a recall with additional products to possible health risk. The Quaker Oats Company, through its authorized distributor, Thompson Trading, announced today an expansion of the December 20th, 2023 recall to include additional items. So some of those items are, and this is on Our News Bahamas, some of those items are oatmeal squares, all berry squares, and their cereal bars. So be aware of that as you go shopping this week. A lot of people do food store runs on Saturdays. That's something to be aware of. And in the one more. Yes. And then three more murders. So they think this one was the last one. Okay. Yeah. So today we're going to talk about crime. We spoke about some of it already in some of the stories this week. It's been in almost every paper this week from Monday to Saturday. From the beginning of this year, we've seen a lot of these murder stories. It's like every 2 days, they're like shootings or murders. And keep in mind that there are 19 murders now. That's where the murder count is for the year. However, there have been a whole lot more shootings. And along with a lot of these things, this is I think one of the highest, if not the highest, that we've ever seen with the murder count. This is like almost unprecedented for the country. And I know some people would be out there like, oh yeah, they're criminals, you know, just let them, you know, kill each other or whatever. But this is a tragedy. We can't pretend like this is not a a national crisis, right? Where we have so much bloodshed happening in our country because we all have to live here. And Alea, you could weigh in on this if you want to a little bit. You could weigh in on this. What do you think? What are your thoughts on this?
I have no words, girl. I was literally listening to you do the news roundup, and I was just thinking, man, like, it's, well, two things stood out to me. One, you had to keep coming back to the murder count. You had to keep coming back to murder, like, throughout the entire time you went through that entire, the week. And that is something that I think is, like, not just concerning at this point. It's so alarming. Like, most people here, I think, in the Bahamas are now, I think now people are starting to realize again, like, this is a problem, or it was a problem, but now this is something that definitely needs to be addressed. And I think, like, this is a systemic failure. Like, this can't just be, we bring in the police to do that thing. Like, we can't just, like, that the time for that, I think, has passed so long ago, where we would say, oh, man, just try one little roadblock, see what they can do. No, like, it's not going to do anything. And along with that, the other thing, not to make light of it, the other thing that really stood out to me was the fact that Bahamians love Quaker so much that we actually had to put that in the newspaper. Like, because no, because I in London, and London don't have no grits, girl. Like, ain't no grits in the shop, okay? My friend from Takes, I had to tell her, I say, listen, now when you go, you got to bring me back a little something.
For real.
She bring me back two big bag of grits. And I want you to know I went on Amazon waiting for her. Mm-hmm. And I bought Prager's grits as well. I imported that from the United States of America.
I like yellow grits, though.
I got me some yellow. I got me some white.
Oh, that's nice. You got the
A little bit of variance, you know?
I always find that very weird, because sometimes, like, if you're away for a long period of time, like, one morning, you're going to feel like eating grits. And in most places you go, like most places you go, even in the States, like, there's, like, pancakes and stuff, but there's no grits. And
no grits. Weird.
But, yeah. But that's a little
odd. You know what's worse? If you go in the U.S. and you're like, I want some grits, guess where you got to go? Cracker Barrel! Cracker Barrel!
I think Denny's has grits as well. But going back to the topic, So along with this bloodshed, the police actually released something this morning. Like, this.
What did they say?
Like, today, like, so, this is from the police crime report this morning. Police investigate fatal stabbing. All right. The police are investigating a fatal stabbing of an adult male that occurred on Saturday, the 27th of January. That's today, at a bar in the vicinity of East Street and Soldier Road. According to initial reports, around 2 a.m., the 18-year-old victim, after being stabbed multiple times to the upper torso, was being transported to the hospital in a private vehicle. However, the driver of the vehicle reportedly lost control while en route to the hospital and crashed into a wall near East Street and Sands Lane. Responding officers and emergency medical technicians arrived on the scene. They examined the victim, but he showed no vital signs of life. The police are urging anyone with information about the stabbing incident to contact 911, 919, or the Criminal Investigation Department, CID, at 502-9991. And anonymous tips are also welcome through Crime Stoppers at 328-TIPS or 328-8477. And I read those really slowly, because I just want people to, and of course you could go on the police website. They have, like, all these numbers listed. And I think on their Facebook page too, they do. So if you know anything about any of these crimes or incidents that's been happening over the last couple of weeks, the police is encouraging anyone with information to speak up. It is a lot. It's a lot. This is, like, really heavy stuff. And, along with the uptick in murder, because if you read through the stories, like, over the last 2 weeks, you just see the increased police-involved shootings as well, because the police are in the streets and they're like, okay, we have to get involved so that innocent people don't get hurt, right? Then you have increased bystanders and getting hit, you know, or shot or stabbed or mistaken identity, like the guy at the gas station this week, who was mistaken for someone else, apparently, and he was targeted and shot in the head, which is just a complete, I don't even know. Like, so you know, as an average person, which is why I said, like, you can't just brush it off to say, oh, this is criminals, because, like, regular day-to-day people who are not involved with any of these things whatsoever are also being impacted by this, you know? And so, and not in a negative way, like, I don't wish this on anyone. God forbid that one day it is you or me. You know what I mean? Because it's some type of somebody decided that they wanted to go out and get revenge on someone else, and we happen to be in the area, or somebody that we love happen to be a mistaken identity, you know? And it's just, like, ridiculous. So another thing that happens as a result of this is increased numbers of families of victims coming. We had the phone Families of All Murder Victims Day last week. And these people are completely crushed. Yes, some of them know that their family members have been involved in some criminal activity, and they're still people, and some of them are not. Some people are just mistaken. You know, like, I can't underestimate, because if you talk to Candy Gibson or anyone who deals with these families of murder victims, they will tell you that sometimes it's not the right person, you know, and human beings, like the police force and the criminal court system, everything is very, it's human constructed, right? It's man-made, mm-hmm. So it's imperfect, right? So sometimes we're not going to get the right person, and that tends to happen. But when you have increased crime and increased incidents, the percentage of those mistaken identities and bystanders getting involved or mixed up increases, right? And it's just completely unhealthy for a country, especially a country as small as ours. And it's not just Nassau, because everyone was just like, oh yeah, all the crime and the murders and stuff in Nassau. We've seen this year, like, it's happened, and even between this year and last year, but this year too, like, it's happened in multiple islands. It's not just only the capital. So yes. Everyone has to be paying attention to this now, right? And there are more people coming out and being like, you know, I was wrongly incarcerated, or my family was wrongly incarcerated. And what happens as a result of that is you have more people going to court and challenging the system and saying, you know, like, this has happened. So, and it causes more of a backup as well, you know, because there are other things, other matters as well. Not to say that these are not things that people should take to court. I encourage people to always seek justice. But it creates more of a burden on an already strained part of our society, right? So this crime is not, it's like people, there are some people so disconnected from it to say that I don't care about this because this isn't impacting me. But it impacts everyone, you know? And we see more double shootings. This week we had a double shooting in Abaco. Like, thankfully, nobody died from that. And we also had a double shooting in Pinewood. And then we had a triple shooting on First Street yesterday. So it was like they doubling and tripling up. Like, it's really, really getting, like, completely out of hand. And the travel advisory that was released this week from the U.S.
Oh, my God, yes.
So all of these things happen. So everybody working in tourism or relying on tourism, a.k.a. the entire country, like, we are all potentially impacted from this. And I've seen the news story with, like, this one tourist they interviewed, and he was like, well, you know, I saw the advisory, but I don't care. He was like, I wanted to come to the Bahamas. I'm here. Like, I'm not concerned.
I cannot lie to you, though. I don't really know if I care about the advisories anymore.
Yeah.
Well, not that I've ever. Mm-hmm. There's always been something unsettling about them for me, in that I have always been, I don't know, I found it kind of annoying. The United States has so much crime relating to Black people.
Yeah.
And so to hear them, the audacity of them, and they say this and put this travel advisory out, I might add, while they actively support and fund a genocide. Mm-hmm. So these are, like, this always goes through my head, like, the audacity mm-hmm. of the United States. Their audacity knows no bounds. you know, the United States really shows every day that they were founded by some straight, wealthy, white, aristocratic men.
I don't know.
Because the way that culture will just permeate, that will give you... No, because it really is. Like, the audacity to put this travel advisory out and then feel away, you know, when we should be doing that. I mean, the fact that, you know, black people were in the grocery stores and they were getting shot. Yeah. You know, they were murdered en masse. The amount of mass shootings in the United States, the amount of violent crime and racial injustice in the United States, let alone the amount of rapes, the crime in the United States is crazy. Mm-hmm. And the audacity, right, to put these things out, it just tickles me. It tickles me every time. And then the fact that we clutch our pearls at it, we should never be afraid of the United States. Mm-hmm. We should never be afraid of the United States. We should never consider anything they do to be important to us. We should acknowledge it, see how it affects us, and move on. Yeah. Because if we seriously look at them, these people who have also single-handedly, along with the UK, I'm sure, and the rest of the European countries, have brought the world to where it is. You know, I don't know. I just can't. Do you agree with the travel advisories?
I understand where you're coming from. The travel advisories to me, because this is not first time at all, but it reminds me of like when I always think, I don't know if this is like a subtle conspiracy theorist somewhere inside of me, but I always think whenever I see a travel advisory that, okay, what's the real agenda here?
Right,
because
what's the real tea?
I remember it was like a cruise line some time ago, like when we had another like spout of murders and crimes and stuff, and some cruise ship like a few years ago was like, oh, travel advisory, you know, don't come off the ship, you know, we're advising you not to come off the ship at all, but if you do, be really, really vigilant, which vigilant, I understand,
right.
I understand the, like, I understand the advisories in saying that we just letting you know, right? But I don't, it does have, like, for me, just like what you said in a way, like some undertones that's like, yeah, you know, these are savages. So remember, like, so that's why I think, like, it always in my mind goes to, I don't know if I'm just a bit sensitive about it because I live here and, you know, and I anticipate the racism, right? The xenophobia, because it does exist. But a lot of these advisories and the people who write them, I think when you read them, the tone, I think it's the tone that makes it feel kind of like you're looking down on something
that.
Else, someone else. Because it's like Chicago, you know, like some parts of New York, Florida, which is the gun capital of the world, one state being the gun capital of the world. Like, I don't, and that's where a lot of the guns trickle in from. Like, there's like so much from that side. That's what I'm saying. Like, there's so much from that side. Like, what's the next one? I think St. Louis is one. They have so much areas that's like that, you know, and for me, it's like, this y'all.
No, for real. Like, this y'all for real.
So I do understand saying that, you know, we want to make sure that people are aware of this, but I don't know if it could be written in like a better way that's more respectful. But I don't know anything about like their standards and type of languages, the language that they have to use when they're sending out advisories. But it does feel sometimes like it's belittling in a way. So I don't, and sometimes it's just because obviously for cruise ships, for my, like I told you, the conspiracy theorist inside me is like, yeah, y'all want people to stay on the cruise ships. Like the goal of a business, right, of most businesses is I want you to stay here. I want you to shop here. If I have the monopoly on this, then that means everybody coming to me. If people are coming off the boat to spend money on Bay Street or in other places in town, then, I mean, that's less money for me, less time people spending on, you know what I mean? So you're trying to control, and then they don't have to worry about, you know, I mean, obviously, some people get leave behind and have to catch a flight and stuff, but they don't have, they could worry less about things like people being left behind. They could worry less about things like people saying, oh, next time I'm going to fly here so I could have more time to hang out in the place. I think they want people to just be into them and what they have to do. And so that's my, I don't know how reasonable like that is, but to me, I always feel like there's a hidden agenda. So, okay, why are you saying this now? Like, what is the motive?
No, I agree.
Behind
I agree.
Every
I
mean, action, especially by a lot of these very large, what do you call them? Like, what do you call them? I mean the countries, the colonizing nations, right? For lack of a better term. Like, a lot of times when I see companies, businesses, people, or the government themselves coming over and saying something, I'm just like, okay, there's a hidden agenda here. You know, and I always have to think about the cause and the intent of what they're saying or the policies that they're trying to push and why they want us to jump on board. I watched this video last night about these people from Greenland, just the indigenous people from Greenland. And there was this man who came from either Europe or the U.S., this white guy, and he was like, oh, you know, and he's from a wealthy family, and they funded his expeditions. This is when everyone, it was like, I think the 1700s or 1800s, when everybody was like, oh, we're going to explore, and we're going to, you know, get all kind of cool stuff and artifacts. And so he went to Greenland, and he found, like, this, these people, like, they had, like, these really sharp tools, and he's like, where the hell did I get this from? It's probably, like, washed up off a shipwreck or whatever. But they were making these tools off this big iron space rock, right? This rock, like, came from space, fell into Greenland. It was made out of iron, and they used to chip away at this rock, like, for hundreds of years. Their families have been doing this, like, chipping away at this rock that they called, in their language, rock from space. And so they knew exactly where it came from, and they used it for generations to make their hunting tools and anything that they needed that was made out of iron. And so first the colonizers came, and they were like, you know what, we're just going to trade with you guys. And then this guy, like, he was getting ready to wrap up all of his expeditions, and he was like, oh, I don't have anything to show for me being an explorer. Ah, what do I do now? And so he convinced them to take him to this iron rock. And he was like, okay, so, you know, I need to borrow this rock and then I'll bring it back. And so the people was just like, okay.
Oh,
like
my
after some hesitation, of course, right? He got one guy to like show him where the rock was. And he was like, you know what? I need help with the rock. And so he got like some of the locals, and he also brought some people of his own to get like all this equipment to help him move the rock. You know, it's back in the day. So they had to bring like rulers and stuff. And so they get the rock, they put it on a ship, and he's just like, I also need to carry a few people because I can't remember why he said he needs to take a few people from here, and then I'll just, you know, everybody could just come back and I'll bring the rock and everything will be cool, right? And so a few people came with him. It was like a husband, a wife, their daughter, and then a man and his son, and then one other guy. And he was like, yeah, we'll be back. And so he took them, and he took the rock to this museum in New York, and he sold the rock for like $4 million in today's currency, right? And he got like that. He got, that was his name, claim to fame, okay? He was like so popular for that. And then he had like these, the people who were there, who he brought, who he said he was going to bring back, they kind of locked them away in the museum, and they died from diseases because, you know, obviously they were not used to being in that type of environment. They put them in like a little stuffy room like under the museum, and they was just like, yeah, y'all live here. And he never took them back because he don't care. He just kind of gave them to this guy in the museum who he made a deal with prior to his trip to Greenland. And he was like, he didn't care anymore. The people died out. Only one boy survived. They took their bodies and they dissected them. They used them for science. They had their bodies, their corpses on display, their bones, their brains and stuff on display. Like, they made a spectacle out of them. And so, like, that's why I said, like, that whole story. And then, like, the little boy who's the only surviving person, his dad died, everybody else died. He was fighting for justice, a justice that he never got. He was asking them so that he could take his father's corpse back to his native land. They told him no, and he never got it. He just died without ever getting it. And so that's why I said, like, the story's like this. And there's so many other examples. Just make me feel like, okay, so what's the agenda?
No, like, I'm with you.
What's really happening here?
Right? Like, right? There's a lot of... That's something I do think about. It's just that there are... Like, for lack of a better word, like you said, they colonized. But that is, like, it is a perfect term when you think about it, because that's their history. And I also think about, like, the diplomatic implications. So was there something done that you know, sometimes that happens where they ask for something, it's not given to them. Mm-hmm. And so they throw a tantrum and, you know, oh, I want this. In reality, I hate that the Bahamas didn't give me this. Like, is there something we didn't give them?
Or something they're bargaining for, and they're saying, like, see, you see
right.
this?
And they didn't
this is going to keep happening to you if you don't do this for us, you know?
Right. So it's like, yeah. I cannot lie to you. That's why I said, like, I'm absolutely over it. I don't think that we need to take anything that the United States in particular, I just don't take them seriously as a nation. They have so many intrinsic problems that they need to fix inside their own country. You know, the fact that they have two terrible candidates right now running for election, for example,
yeah,
for one.
I can't even disagree.
Just so deeply unhappy with, and they are still running it despite that. You know, the fact that, like, their party system is flawed and is not going to work.
But that shows you, like, that's a good example, Alea, of how people who, like, the people who represent or, like, go along with the system, they're just like, we're going to put this body here because we know that they'll do what we ask them to do. And so we have these people running who aren't even capable of really, they're not in the best condition. You know what I mean? So you end up having people leading the country just because you feel safe with them, or you feel like they're both safe choices. One represent, like, he's been there forever. So you'd be like, yeah, we know what he's going to do. And we know that this is, we know what he's going to do. We know what he's about. He's a safe choice. So just leave him there, right? Like, not even thinking about the fact that maybe this isn't a good idea to keep this person here for other reasons, and also for his own personal health, you know, and things like that. And then there's another candidate who's just like, oh yeah, we know we could win with him. And so it's like, they don't even, like, the integrity part of it is, like, completely removed and stripped away, because it's just like, we're not, and we do it here in the Bahamas too. It's like, we're not even looking for the best person who genuinely cares and is trying to push for good, decent, ethical policy. We just want someone who we know will win. Because we want to say at the end of the day that our party won. You know, if people cared more about people's values and who they are and their character, then none of these candidates here or in the States or in most other countries, they wouldn't even be there. You know? Mm-hmm. And the fact that they have to pay so much for their PR teams to make them look good and to keep them looking good and to convince the public that they are good people. Like, you shouldn't have to do that. The fact that you have to do that in the first place is a red flag, you know?
Yeah, that speaks volumes.
Yeah, so anyway, I'm still on this list, you know, talking about the things that come from this uptick in murder, which is so gloomy. So, like I said, increased police-involved shootings, increased bystanders, mistaken identities, members of families and victims coming forward saying that they were wrongly accused or incarcerated, the double shootings, the triple shootings. I don't know if we're going to have a quadruple shooting, knock on wood, God forbid, and travel advisories, and then the government, and the government, you had the PM talking this week about amendments to the Bail Act, and that bail would be automatically revoked for people who are accused of committing offenses while on bail. While I think that's a step in the right direction, I think that we're still putting a band-aid over a deep cut.
Yeah, no, I wholeheartedly agree. I don't know what's up with
and
that.
And it ain't a big bandit. It's like the little circles, you know, like the little tiny ones they give you after the needle.
The little tiny ones that
yeah.
Right on.
Yeah, that's the bandit.
I don't know what's up with that, though. Like, I feel like we on a hamster wheel when it comes to crime and a lot of the systemic issues. And I think that all comes back to this idea of, like, the people in power everywhere not necessarily having any skin in the game, right? So why should they come up with a solution when they're not really being affected by it?
Yeah. Because most of these people live in, like, they live behind, like, security walls. Like, yeah, they live in gated communities. They live in, you know, they have bodyguards, high security. They're not being impacted as intensely.
They're important enough. Yeah. If something happens to them or their families, they are important enough to get the attention of the police.
Yes. And then the police will solve it faster. Like, if you know somebody. Right. And that's another problem. And it speaks to not just that, not just crime or murder or anything, but like if you know somebody, like the system that we live in this country, is like, if you know somebody, then you're straight. Right. And like, that's, yeah, but that's not cool. Like it should, like, that should not be that's not justice at all. You know, like it's a slap in the face of justice. It's just, and it's deplorable. Like it should not be happening. What's the next one I have here? So, yeah, but I do think that is a step in the right direction. I think the government has a lot on their plate right now. I feel like crime is just like really, really adding to that pressure. And I think this might be the thing that this administration has to, because I feel like they had like a smooth ride so far. This
compared to
me,
the last,
yeah,
sure.
Yeah. To me, this looks like it could be possibly, because at first people was like, oh, you know, this, they're gonna be in for two terms. That's the same thing they said about the last administration, and
really
that fell on its face hard. So, because that was like a landslide victory for the Progressive Liberal Party. Now, this time, I was looking like up to like last year, like last summer, I was saying like, yeah, this kind of looks like they might make it to two terms, because there hasn't been anything where they had to
anything
say, okay,
tried.
I have to
yeah.
prove myself, right? For
right.
the previous administration, there was Hurricane Dorian, there was the pandemic.
And there was COVID.
There was,
yep.
yeah, there was like all different things happening, right? But right now, I'm like, they were looking good, but now this crime thing might be the thing that this administration has to prove themselves worthy on,
yeah.
right? This is a challenge here, right? Because the tourism numbers went up, which obviously they were, because before the pandemic happened, it was always on an upward trajectory, right?
It was.
So,
and then it just had
yeah.
to stop.
And especially with now, like, a lot of influencers and travel. Like, traveling is a thing now. Like, it's always been a thing, but now it's a thing. So everybody wants to do it. Like, it's just like, oh, yeah, pictures of me on vacation, swimming with
right.
the sharks in a glass kayak in Exuma. Like, and most people haven't even heard of the names of these islands. Like, you say you was in Acklands or Crooked Island. Like, some of these words you will type in on Microsoft Word, and it have, like, a red squiggly line under it. Like, you spelled something wrong.
Yeah.
And so
which
people...
Which is great. I cannot lie. I find that to be great. I think, like, that like, the exploitation of
the best kept secrets.
Is something, yeah, like, we need to... And I'm not to say that I'm just really protective of it, because that's also something for me, and it's going to continue to be something for me until somebody steps up and changes it. I'm never happy about tourism numbers being like up, because mm-hmm. tourism is this industry that, you know, we created, that was crafted by Nazis
yeah.
and was crafted by, and I'm not trying to be like that one
say
person
Nazis.
Like to make it negative or anything, but like literally, because the Stafford Sands brought over somebody who was in Hitler's parliament.
Oh,
Hitler's
goodness.
Cabinet,
yeah,
you know
we actually
mean?
Do have a history of a lot of Germans coming to the Bahamas. I don't know what their affiliation was, but there is a history here. We have like German settlements in some islands, so that's
do?
A thing.
Ooh.
Yeah,
I didn't even mean that. I was just referring to the fact that Hallmarstadt helped create the tourism economy. This is powerful, though.
Yeah, I don't
so,
know their political
like
allegiances.
That?
But yeah, there's like a lot of things happening here. Like we have like Mennonites, apparently. We have like Amish. We have a big Jewish population as well. I did not know. Like there's a lot
that's
of
what I'm saying.
There's like, a lot of here. Yeah. So, and even we have like Russians, Ukrainians, so it's just like Ukrainians. And it's like, yeah, it's big Ukrainian community in Grand Bahama. I'm just like, what?
See, yeah. It's yeah, like
people
come here, white communities come here. And they come here knowing that there's safety and refuge. And while I appreciate that, how it's just a level of like the level in which they contribute versus the Haitian Bahamians, Jamaican Bahamians, who have consistently put their lives on the line and have gotten nothing but discrimination for it. Whereas all these white foreigners have to do is come over here, be mediocre and be white and all is good.
I blame us partially though for that. I do. I blame us partially because we've drank that Kool-Aid, man. I think we're inching away from it. Generally as a country, we're inching away from that. But
yeah.
even if you saw what happened when the royalties were coming. Right?
Oh,
it was just like, Prince so and so and his wife is gonna be here. Kate Middleton and what's the prince? Sorry, I don't keep up with them very good.
Not
Harry,
fine.
His brother. What's the next one?
William,
William and Kate. So they were coming over and they were just like, oh, you know, the royalties, and then people just like, ah, oh, it is such a privilege. So while a lot of other Caribbean countries are like crying and fighting, just like reparations, y'all gonna have to pay when y'all come here and all this stuff. And the Bahamas is just like, come, we love you, come to Papa.
and we coddle
that idea. And so you had a lot of Bahamians, like older Bahamians, coming up and saying like, we should be honored to even have them step foot on this Bahama land, you know, like, so there's so much reverence and love there. And not to say that I don't have a problem with people liking other people or being fans, like how people are fans of like celebrities and stuff. It's cool. Right. But it's just like the amount of like honor that goes behind people who kind of, you know, the family that, you know, the history, you know, slavery and built their entire country's wealth off the backs of our ancestors. Like that's a real vibe. I can understand if people are fans of like the fashion or the like the allure of the royalty, this and that, but I don't get the praise and admiration and devote honor and like to like a subservient way, you know what I mean, to be like bowing down almost to like everything. The culture is cool, right? We get it. I love tea, right? I can't stop drinking tea, which is actually Chinese Indian, but most of the teas I drink are English teas. Like imported from British, and I do like the little pomp and pageantry of the little like doily and the little short laced like eyelet. What do you call them? Gloves and stuff. So that's cute. But at the same time, like running behind and honoring and bowing down to, I don't think that's, I think that's a bit much, you know? And I think we need to like tap in more to our history because a lot of it was taken away from us and we're kind of getting there, but we have not gotten there yet, which is sad. But I don't know if history is like really a priority because a lot of times it's kind of like shoved out of the way for other subjects or other interests. And people just label it as boring. And when that happens, then we end up repeating our mistakes from the past, right? So that's not bad. But that's my feelings on history. We went from bail to history.
But you know what? No, that's like that. I think that just shows that a lot of our problems, like if it's a systemic problem, it goes back to things. Like the thing about crime, like that, before you had arrived, I was just saying like my opinion on it, which was that a lot of people, because we had this huge talk about capital punishment this week as well.
Yeah.
So many different debates, lots of different, you know, opinions on it. And I have always said, like, the idea of, like, capital punishment, it only goes so far. Mm-hmm. And, like, if you're trying to actually solve crime, you have to look at the systems that we put people in. And that'll give, you know what I mean? Like, that'll give us everything we need. And that's all about, like, looking at the historical foundations of what crime has been in the country, the history of capital punishment, even down to little things like education, the liability. Like, mm-hmm, there have been countless studies around the world about what people have been through, why people turn to lives of crime.
Yes. Yes. Oh, and did you see, I think it was a perfect example and also a missed opportunity for a big discussion where there was a kid in, I think it was Grand Bahama last week. There was so much incidents. I'm trying to keep track, so forgive me if I am off about any of this, but there was a stabbing in, I believe, Grand Bahama, where the student was asked, it might have been Nassau, but the student was asked to join a gang. He was approached by some other students. He was like, no, I don't want to join your gang. Bye. And they, like, attacked him, and they brutally stabbed him. And he was in the hospital. He didn't die, I don't think. But they said he was hospitalized. And that is it there. That is how a lot of these kids, like, when you see these parents on the news crying and saying that, oh, these people aren't bad kids. These boys are not, like, my son is not a bad person and all these things. These are children who were coaxed into or groomed by older kids or, like, young adults. And you could tell by the ages of these kids, like, they're, and I call them kids, they're, like, you know, like, quite younger than me, right? I call them kids now. I'm 30. So they're, like, between the ages of, like, 16 to 25 most of the time. And it's just, like, you don't become a big gangster and a person who's done multiple murders by the age of 25 if you were not approached or being groomed from you were in high school. And so a lot of these kids get confronted by other members in these gangs from, and I think, who told me this? I think it was Ian Bethel Bennett, the professor at UB. A lot of them are approached. They did, like, studies on this, by the way. So a lot of them are approached on their ways to school, on their way from school, while they're in school.
Wow.
And so that, like I said, that story there, that is the birth of all, like, not all, but the vast majority of these murders and this crime. Yes, some of them go to it as a place of, like, refuge or a place where they can say, I will be protected, kind of like a brotherhood or something. So, but a lot of it is still, I was approached and I had no choice. They were going to stab me up. They was like, these children were literally being held at gunpoint. You know, like, whether it's like where people, the old people are like, did someone hold a gun to your head? And you know what I mean? To say, like, oh, I had to do it. And it's like, what do you mean you had to do it? Someone hold, like, they're literally, like, these children literally have knives and guns to their head to join these gangs a lot of the time. And you know, when you talk to, I've, like, done a lot of stories on this too. I've talked to, like, Carlos Reed, and even the police officers, and covering all this crime stories. I've talked to Candy Gibson a lot, extensively, from FOAM. Like, and a lot of these stories just keep coming up, and you keep hearing it over and over again. So it's just like, if you saying this, and from all these different angles, and then you listen to these court cases where people talk about their story, then you realize that, hey, yeah, this is a problem. Like, these children are being recruited. This is like a recruiting assignment. It's like, you know how the military, like, recruits people to join the army? It's like that. It's similar to that. It's similar to how in Brazil they have, like, a serious problem with this. Like, the kids are, like, really, really, really young who are recruited. And in some, like, I don't like to use this broad term, but I watch so much news and I really get confused a lot of times because there's so many countries in Africa suffering with similar issues. In some African countries, right? Don't beat me for that term. But in some of them, where the kids, like, young people have to pick up arms, and it's not because I want to be a gangster or I want to be a bad person or I want to, like, shoot up people. It's like, I am fighting for my life.
Yeah.
I'm literally fighting for my life, or I'm trying to survive. I'm bearing a burden that you can't understand. And so when a police officer comes up in your face and, you know, like, or they arrest you, or they start beating you with something, like, you feel the need to, like to attack them because you have all of this inside you. Like, what do you think that does to a person's psyche? And what do you think that does to a person's soul? And you know, and their state of being, like, what is my value? Like, what is my worth? Like, we have so many young men, like, dying left, right, and center. Like, so, and I know everybody says it all the time, like, oh, what's happening to the young men? But seriously, what is happening, right? And this is a part of it. And that, I think that same, like, recruitment, those recruitment encounters, a lot of them, that's where it started. That's where it's bred. And that's where, that is where the focus needs to be. Why is this happening? And who is sending these children to recruit these other kids? And where does this culture come from?
Man,
because
Crystal,
it's
that
growing.
Was
that
was deep.
It's hard. It's really hard for these kids. And then they grow up angry because nobody understands them or what they had to suffer through. That is the heart of it. Putting a police in a school ain't gonna help. Like, I guess that's a step in the right direction, but it just make the children more cunning and crafty. They see y'all a long time. They know how to dodge y'all. They've been doing it. But you have to meet them where they are. And I think that's a disconnect between the police and the citizens. It's like the police don't even try a lot of times to even, and I'm not trying to like whip the police with this because I know they have their challenges too. And a lot of issues that they have to face. And this crime situation is really a burden and a strain on a lot of police force and officers. And if my family member was a police, I would have been scared for my life. Like, I would have prayed over them every day, anointed them in the oil, you know, the blood of Jesus, pray the blood of Jesus over them. Because I would have been really scared that they would get hurt. But I think that there could be a more sensitive approach sometimes, depending on the situation, right, towards some of these, because some of these young men, they just want someone to listen to them. And, you know, and a lot of times they're not given that opportunity to do so. So, the last point I had on this whole long list I went through today was, the police has to heighten their efforts. So that ties in perfectly. So now the police has to heighten their efforts. They have to work harder. But I think that there's also a need for them to meet the people who are committing the offenses. Because I don't want to call on them criminals or who are them believed to be committing the offenses. Where they are. So that's something to sit on and think on as we cut quickly to this commercial break, and then we'll be back and Dawn will be joining us, and we also have a special guest.
There it is.
Wait. Find what you love. Sharp under pressure, thinking diamond. All eyes on me like a conductor. That means just play your role, you might get chopping. Wait, play the game to change the game. Word of Gooch, that's my hitter. Your wave is living in the moment, huh? My wave is living for me.
Oh, I know what I'm doing. Yeah, I know what I'm doing, baby. Say, I know what I'm doing. Talk about a revolution.
There it is.
Wait.
Love the show? Want to give your support? Become a sponsor today. Call 302-2300 for our rates and packages. That's 302-2300. Become a sponsor on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Struggling to repay your loan? Let us help you get back on track with payment terms that suits your financial situation and improve your credit score and credit report with the Bahamas Credit Bureau. Inquire about our restructured loans today. Call us at 356-7764.
Foreign Currency brings you the African Giant, live in concert, Burna Boy! Burna Boy performing live! Saturday, February 17, taking place at Clifford Park with Burna Boy performing live! Also performing Rich Homie Quan, 38 Afri, Joe Capone, Bax Civelli, Ratty Pinder, Bloody, Fat Shot, Puzzle, Judah the Lion, and Jay Shepherd. Hosted by Natural Empress, Rika C, Pencil, and Aaron Rain. Music by the country's top DJs, Overdose, DJ Tag, DJ Hennessy, DJ Matt Bull, AJ Unruly, DJ Melody, Spilling Again 2024. Saturday, February 17th at Clifford Park with Burna Boy. Get tickets now. The name of the game is to be on the scene.
Are you looking for a fresh experience? Look no further than Fresh Market. Our store is stocked with the freshest produce, meats, and dairy, all sourced locally and internationally for the best quality. With our commitment to freshness and our friendly associates, your shopping experience is sure to be a breeze. Come visit Fresh Market today and taste the difference freshness can make.
Girl, Junior just showed me Bulla Boy in his phone.
What you mean? He take picture of that good for nothing boy?
Shh, you don't want Bulla hair, you say that. You know she always say that's my good child.
So what he doing in Junior phone?
Oh, he there cause the police looking for him. He on that wanted list.
Wanted persons in your phone now?
Yes, child. And when police won't find anybody quick, after something happened, they can send picture direct to your phone. Go to Google Play or App Store and search for Crack Crime Bahamas, then pick install and it will go straight to your phone.
There is also a section on missing persons.
Yes, girl. Everybody needs to get this app so police can tell us right away when these people go missing. Just like an alert system.
Yes, it has numbers for Crime Stoppers Bahamas so you can call and nobody knows you. Call directly to Miami and give the information without giving your name or anything about you. I tried the other day and when I hear Junior and his boys talking about where they hide those guns, I walk quick around the corner and call that number.
Call 328-8477 from Nassau or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back to the Eye Opener, your weekly dose of something absolutely different. This is obviously the second half of the show. I wasn't here for the first half, but I did listen in. Unfortunately, you guys did touch on, I should say extensively, the absolute carnage of the streets of New Providence. And I can't just squarely put this on New Providence because we're also seeing it in Freeport, seeing it in Abaco. So I don't know. Is this like the way the Bahamas is just going to be in the future? It seems as though maybe I'm wrong. Aaliyah, are you still there? Oh, I think we may have lost her. Okay. It seems as though to me that all I hear about is the absolute degradation of our society. But not just that. It seems that men in the Bahamas just ain't doing the things that they need to be doing. Even when I go to seminars about entrepreneurship and business, it is 80% women. If I go to a town hall meeting, it is 80% women.
Well, hold on. A lot of the men are dead.
Yes. And it seems like fellas ain't out here. I don't know if they're all dead, but it's like fellas just ain't doing nothing. And I have to think to myself, like, what is happening around me? Literally, even when I teach classes at university now, like, majority of my classes are 80%
women. Well, a lot of times the men just out there working or doing something else, you know. That's the next
I'm not saying that you're wrong.
Because academic is, like, kind of like in a modern type of...
But the people running institutions now, the people in majority of managerial positions, it seems, is skewing heavily towards women. I'm not against that. I'm just saying...
It's kind of shifted because back in the day, the teachers, a lot of teachers were men. A lot of professors were men. But then after the Second World War, we saw more women enter that, and that's continued to increase.
I think there are more professional women than there are men, period.
And in the in our, I don't want to call it a third world country. What do you call it? Developing nations.
Yes. Sure, sure.
In developing nations, like, and in Central and South America, where we're kind of there, you do see the majority of women in academic institutions. So that's not just here.
No, that's internationally. That's around the world. Yeah. That's
entirely it's growing now in the larger countries.
No, it's not growing. It's beyond that point.
Yes, Don. But I mean, if you look at the percentage of women at UB and percentage of the women in a large school in the United States, one of their biggest schools, you will see that there's a lot of women, but locally there are way more women.
No, but even in the States,
Central
it's
South America, it's way more women.
In ratio, even in the United States, though, it's 65% women on college campuses
it's growing,
on average.
But they can't touch us. That's what I try.
We're leading it.
Yes.
But this is the question I have to continue to ask, right? Like, what the hell is actually happening? Right, because you just look around what's happening in terms of the education system, students graduating from high school. I looked at the stats of graduation, and I broke them down to male to female. I don't know if that data is 100% accurate, but oh boy, is it painting a terrible picture.
Yeah, it's on the website. When I saw it, it is depressing. Last time,
to say the least.
It was like hardly any men are graduating. Like, they may enroll, but by the time it's time to graduate, the percentage of male to women, male to female, it's like, really, really.
It's an interesting thing. So let's go and take this quick call, and we're going to do, I wouldn't call it a gear change, but I want to shift a bit of the lens of what we look at and how we look at our country to an island of this country that seems to be on its own trajectory, separate and apart from Abaco, Grand Bahama, and New Providence, right? It's very interesting what's happening on this magical island of magical mouses and cruise ships, but we shall see. Good morning, caller. You are on the air.
Yes, morning.
Good morning this morning.
Yes, you know, how is it that I don't hear much about the social scientists of the world, their studies, you know, like the UN studies and these organizations that do these things, that collect data, that says that crime and the disparity or the gap in the wealth in wealth has an integral part, a very important part in crime. You know, and you know, in this country, it seems our society are cold to this fact, they don't care about these facts. You know, there's no discussions about these facts. You know, we talk, and then on another hand, we love to talk about taking the poor people's rights or the criminals' rights to their human rights in the court of justice. You know, we have the small crime, people doing the small crimes, going to jail, going to court without lawyers. You know, in violation of their human rights. You know, international organizations tell us that, but our politicians, they push that aside and say, "Oh, we're too small a country. We can't afford it. Come on, man." You know, I'm a child of immigrants, right? But I see where in this country, in my field, Where there's no such thing as a behemoth in construction, the job that we used to do, our parents used to tell us, you don't do good in school, you got to go into construction because that's your only hope. Seems like there's no hope for the young men in this country. There's no hope. The only hope for them is jail, you know. And people left to talk, and then me, sweat the small stuff. And then the small criminal go to jail. There's not a library in jail. There's no rehabilitation in jail. Nothing to do. 24/7 lockdown. You understand me? So it's us as the people. We love to call the poor people lazy, but they are part of us. You know, wealthy among us. We have some people that they beat all odds. People that single parent and no mother, no father become they become wealthy, but they and then they say, oh, they could do it. Everybody could do it, but not and we know definitely it's the system. You know, we have the system that legislate. You know, for their greed, and we got to address the greed in society and in the world. You understand me? Mm. But anyway,
thank you so much, caller.
Yeah.
He raised some really good points.
He did, and it makes me think. Well, there's actually a study that came out not the other day, it's like literally yesterday, this week. It was a study basically looking at ideology between men and women across four countries, South Korea, the United States, Germany, and the UK. Turns out men are turning extraordinarily hard to conservatism and to the right, and women are turning in the opposite direction hard to the left. So I don't know. This is an international phenomenon we're facing. Of course, these countries are not facing, well, they are, some of the same issues. But I want to do a bit, I wouldn't call it a gear change. I wanted to focus in on, because we have pretty much been drowning in New Providence of news every single morning, every night, of the pop, pop, pop sounds that we hear all the time, right? And the sirens and the whole thing. But there's an island that's very dear and near to me. It's near to all of us. We should all travel there at some point in time. The island of Eleuthera. If you've ever been to Eleuthera, it's a wonderful place. Bryland Sweet, so is Spanish Wells, so is Governor's Harbor, so is most of the island. You should visit James' sister and all these different places. But it's a good friend of mine, and a good friend of the show. I don't know if I should call it. I should call it your whole title? Should I say the whole thing? It's fine. The CEO of the One Eleuthera Foundation, Kieron Smith. Oh, yes. And also is he communications director? Chief! Yolanda, can you hear us?
Hi there. Hello. Yes, I can. I had a little dip in internet, but I can hear you, and I am here.
Are you in Eleuthera at the moment?
I am in beautiful Eleuthera. Yes, I am. I'm happy to tune in and be on the show with you guys. I've been listening in.
You want
to
switch places? Just for a weekend.
I can extend an invitation for a visit, but no, we can't switch, but I can definitely.
No mind, just a weekend. You come to Nassau for a week and you know, the traffic ain't so bad now.
Stop it.
With modern technology, I'm sure you could work some sort of a hybrid situation.
A hybrid? Boy, I don't know. No, this is an absolutely beautiful day. I'm sure. How is the weather in Eleuthera anyway?
Oh, it's gorgeous. It's a beautiful beach day, nice breezy island weather, laid back, no traffic. As you know, there are no traffic lights in Eleuthera. So we're just easy cruising through and enjoying all of this tropical weather.
Boy, I get like one thing I like about Lucha is going top and big. Sitting man, looking at the water, having a collect. Anyway, that's enough about me. So yes, the One Eleuthera Foundation, you guys are a non-governmental organization. You've been in the island of Eleuthera how many years now?
Who, me? I've been here for 3 years.
No, I mean, you mean the organization has been...
Oh, well, the organization has was established in 2012, but of course our president, or the founder of the organization, had been on the ground doing work and creating... sort of a segue into One Eleuthera for probably 5-6 years before that. But officially 2012, One Eleuthera was established.
One Eleuthera, in my opinion, has always been a bit of a bright spot. We did a tour, I'm saying we, but there was a tour for University of the Bahamas students a few years back where we used to do those retreats on the island of Eleuthera. I'm sure, Kieron, you did a lot of those. You used to be the president of COBUS. You're the first president of the SGA for the University of the Bahamas, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
Well, Kieron, I know why you're getting all silent.
Like, he's trying to be humble. You know, he's a very humble man.
So you always have this thing. They say, God give us two ears and one mouth. So
yep.
Sometimes you need to listen more than
boy.
You speak.
So, but when it was in Eleuthera, we did this thing where we did the retreat, obviously, and we went around. But also, One Eleuthera did a small exercise with us where they took us around a tour of the facility. When I say facility, it's the One Eleuthera compound. We did some, I think we did a class there. And then after that, We got to visit where the, which was shocking to me, the volunteer ambulance and fire engine.
Yep, yep.
And they basically told us in no uncertain words that basically, Eno ambulance and fire engine like that on the island, right? Especially not in South Eleuther's part. And I thought this was just like, oh, maybe this is just an Eleuther problem. Only to discover when talking to especially Fami Island students, they was like, yeah, it's the same way the island from, the same way in Cat Island.
No, it's not, because a lot of the islands don't have any.
No, I meant they have nothing.
Yeah.
At all.
No, at least, no, in Eleuthera, they have like volunteer. And yeah. Some islands, they have volunteer. Some islands have, I think
it's three islands with volunteer services. Yes.
It had a donation. Sometimes like these companies would donate an ambulance.
Well, the private citizens have to solicit these things. Yeah.
Public-private partnerships.
So one Eleuther basically fills a gap in what happens, which sounds like a bright spot to me because, you know, there's a lot of not so bright spots.
Yeah, thank God. We're talking about Eleuther because every time I hear about it, especially when I tune in, you know, it sometimes makes me want to just return my ticket and just stay in Eleuther every now and then.
Absolutely. But we are at basically don't the end of like January.
That, you can't be brand new.
No, I know, right? He's going to stay in Eleuther. Don't come to visit nobody. But we are in January. It's an absolutely new year, 2024. I wanted to bring you on last year, Kieron, but obviously your schedules doesn't always align. Yolanda, you as well. But, you know, everybody doing things, I doing things, traveling, all sorts of things. We finally got each other.
Yep.
Remotely in the same place to be free at around the same time. And we wanted to talk a bit, well, quite extensively about One Eleuther Foundation, because you guys are basically, I dare say, are you trying to do a Herculean task.
Oh, it is.
Because you're doing agriculture, you train for tourism, you offer basically employment opportunities for persons on the island of Eleuthera. You basically, in my opinion, are an extension of government. But from the private side, filling gaps where central government just simply cannot.
Failed.
I think you touched on an important point. You know, the reality of it is, you know, government just can't do everything. And as much as we try to put that big burden and say, hey, it's the government to do this and the government to do that, I still think organizations like One Eleuther, civil society, private sector, all of us have a role to play in the community and filling these gaps and dealing with these needs. And I think the One Eleuther approach has always been, hey, we're going to get this thing going and it'll catch on. And once it catch on, there's to be this saying, and I used to talk to Sean about this. He used to say, Kieron, where the people go, in some instances, the politicians will follow. And being able to create a system to help support the island, and in many instances, I think we were being able to do that has been a support to the community. I think it's been even support the government in many instances in trying to get that burden lifted. But it's good when everybody can come together and really drive sustainable change in our communities.
Yeah.
How long are you in town for, Kieron?
I'm here till next week, Monday.
Oh, okay, never mind. So I was going to ask.
Trying to get them booked out. Here.
No, because some things are happening, but I'll talk about that off air.
We can talk about that. I'll be back next week, though.
I agree with you, Kieron, to an extent, but I think that the government could do more. And I know that's such a like cliche term, that the government could do more. I just feel like they kind of concentrate everything, and it should be more of a structure where it's like, okay, we have a local government here that will assist will assist and hold hands with the NGOs, our community partners, the businessmen on the island, people who want to start businesses on the island, the children, the community, everything. And like, if that could be, that would be the ideal thing. However,
it's funny you say that, because
however, it's not that way. So I think that the government can do more, but I know obviously the government cannot do everything. But our family islands, for me, that's a sensitive spot. The family islands, having lived on a family island before in San Salvador, and San Salvador is what they call a hardship island, right? They haven't lived on family islands. You could see that it is. Like sometimes it feels like nobody really care about you. You know what I mean? As a citizen, you should never feel that way. And it's like the politicians are so distant.
And there's really no one there to speak on your behalf like that, you know, because you have to catch them when you catch them and they're preoccupied. So definitely there needs to be more government representation in these islands. And one family island administrator having that task is too much.
Yep.
There needs to be more. So
it's not going to happen.
And that will help the islands be organized because the islands are draining. Everyone is leaving the farm. The islands come to the capital.
But this is the interesting thing about this conversation, right?
Yeah.
Is the reason why I wanted you guys to come on to talk about it, too, is one, I won't get on an asshole. But two,
it's a lot to unpack with about.
Yes. But two, it is. I like that you brought up the point about people basically wanting to go back to the farming islands.
Yeah,
there's a lot of people that want to. But the problem is there enough opportunity for them to go back? And it's kind of saddening sometimes when I have students from Eleuthera, usually from the Bluff, North Eleuthera, etc. I think I have one student from Greencastle who basically say they have no intention of returning to their island. They want to, but the opportunity just isn't there for them. At least that's the way that they feel. And my thing was, is like looking at the One Eleuthera Foundation, looking at, I think Exuma has one as well. It's called One Exuma, I think, or Exuma Foundation. They have a foundation.
They do have the Exuma Foundation.
It's not as big as One Eleuthera. But the thing I was thinking about is, what position do you guys actually play? Since we're obviously not going to get support up and now from the government of the Bahamas for the development of Famianas. What position do you guys necessarily play in this game of developing our Famianas, is particularly Eleuthera?
Well, it's interesting you say that because I think it's so many angles to come at this with. You know, Crystal talked about the need for Famialan development. And, you know, I did my research, and my research was around decentralization of local government, the need for more decentralization of power. And I think that's a whole nother conversation we could have. But in the context of Eleuthera, I think one of the ways that we see ourselves, and we have a program, a project that we're developing right now, and it's more nonprofit based, is how do we replicate our model in our islands, in the Bahamas, and regionally? I think we've been able to have a successful model in that sense. Mm-hmm. And so now what we're doing is we have, you know, we have so many people that call us, hey, can you tell us a little bit about how do you get set up? How did you get registered? How do you get going with these projects, programs? Where did you get funding? How did it happen? And we're like, we need to be able to share our model with other persons so that they can replicate and have another. It might not be a One Eleuthera, but it might be a Exuma Foundation, like you say. It might be a foundation in Abaco. But how do they learn lessons from us, learn from our successes, learn from our failures, and be able to replicate our model across the Bahamas? I think that is one way of doing that. I think the other way is the advocacy, that we have to push more and stress the importance of family island development. And
responsible family.
And responsible family island development. I'm glad you said that.
Sustainable.
Yeah, glad you said that, Don. But that's all. That's another.
I know, because, you know, generational property ain't recognized by some people, you know. Yep. Sometimes the sun does just shine in certain directions.
But sustainable development. So it's not something that, oh, we started this year, but then there's no plan moving forward to say how we're going to do this. And so with that same concept in mind, Ron, I know One Eleuthera has had its share of challenges throughout the years, right? And then you also had to deal with COVID and other issues, right?
Yeah.
How would you say, like for other people who have organizations or want to start, how do you overcome those issues? Like, what is, just in a nutshell, what is the remedy to like kind of sort through that type of challenges?
I think it starts with people. You know, we always think we need a million people in the world to solve or change something, and I think it starts with a group of people who are interested in seeing change in their communities, who are willing to take a stance, and who are willing to be dedicated and loyal to a cause. I think that's one starting point. Oftentimes, you know, we've had conversations with other persons who want to develop similar models. But one of the things we recognize is you need a jockey. You need somebody who's going to get on that horse and pave and just pound the pavement, who's going to take it. Who's going to be that person pounding and knocking on doors to get things done? You're going to need that person. Okay. Go ahead.
A lot of times, as you said, group of persons, right? a lot of times we've seen in our families, our communities, our churches.
Yep.
When you have a group, at some point, like, everything may be going good for some point, but at some point there's going to be like a row.
Oh yeah.
How do you solve arguments in a constructive way where this argument is not going to take out what we initially started fighting for? We have some different thoughts, but
I think you find that all the time in organizations. So it's always that group dynamics of forming, forming, storming, norming, reforming, and adjourning. And I think some of those dynamics, and you'll find it, but I think ways that you can get over that is when those rows happen, there need to be some people who are in the room who can say, hey, let's come to the table and let's have a conversation. Now, you're going to have some people who are not interested, but once you set your strategic direction of where you headed, who is willing to move with you? You need to move with those persons in that sense. And I say that because oftentimes we have these, and let's be honest, Family Islands are very different communities than Nassau.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And in many instances, they can be very communal. When I think about Eleuthera.
Nosy. That's what I think of. Everybody knew your business.
Well, if you think
some people call it
imagine since all
every community has, they want this thing. So you have South Eleuthera, you have Central Eleuthera, you have North Eleuthera, and everybody have a way of how they want to do things. And I think sometimes that can be a challenge with Family Island development. But I think when you're able to come to the table, have conversations, and I think this is one of the things that Sean was able to do. Sean said when he came back to Eleuthera that he says he saw a lot of these models that were around, that were existing. He said he wanted to create something different. And what he did is he found a group of people who cared about a common cause, who were willing to take it to the next step and move it forward. And they ran with the people they have to get things going and off the ground. And so I think part of it is that is unavoidable.
Conflict.
Conflict is unavoidable. It's how you deal with conflict.
I got some conflict to discuss.
And
go ahead, Yolanda.
I think also too strong leadership is important when we talk about this. I was listening earlier when you were referencing the situation with crime and how do we kind of get back to what is reasonable for our country. And a lot of times it's taking responsibility. And I think the way to relate the two is that when communities take responsibility for themselves and for what takes place within their area of influence, I think at that level is where we can start to rebuild. It's too big a problem to just address broadly, but certainly if each community can take responsibility for just what's in front of them on their doorstep. And that's kind of like, in a way, the way One Eleuthera was modeled. Just being able to maximize what we have, create linkages to resources, step in and address the challenges and problems that were there for us. And in many ways, that same kind of thinking and modeling can then be translated to other communities in New Providence, on other islands. Money exists out there. Resources are out there to fund the structuring, the positions, the people that need to be paid to do the work. But if there has to be strong leadership, there has to be transparency, and there has to be skin in the game. And like Kiran says, people have to put their differences aside and they have to put what the cause is, what the gain is, that's the most important part. The mission must come first. And we have this quote that we always include on our weekly meetings. It says, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has. And that's a quote by Margaret Mead. So we can't look at what we don't have. We have to look at what we do have and what we can maximize to make a difference. But starting on with the problems that we can address that are right in front of us. And then we can appreciate the cumulative effect once we've remained consistent to the cause and mission.
I love that. We're going to take this quick call, and I got some controversial questions to ask y'all, but that's okay. It's going to be great. It's going to be great. It ain't too controversial. Just talking about how development structures, right? I know you're already, man. I know you're already. Good morning, Carl. You are on the air.
Yeah, good morning.
Good morning this morning.
Yeah, good morning to you and your guests and to the Bahamas. I really was calling because last week you had a topic on the golf courses, right? Remember that?
We did touch on that.
Right, and with Craig Flowers. And of the golf course there by the Sports Center.
Mm-hmm.
And one, and someone that was on with you, they gave their opinion, say they don't believe in golf courses because it's a waste of land, right?
Yes.
Remember that?
Yes.
Well, you know, that person needs to understand that a golf course encompasses the whole economic scope, you know what I mean, of living. Because here you have where you go out there and it gives you the opportunity for walking. It gives you the opportunity for exercising. The birds, the natural pigeon plum and all the natural fruits in the within the vegetation between the golf holes are there. If you see where I'm coming from, right?
Mm.
Now, people look at golf, riding around on the golf carts, but golf really is a walking and exercising environment. So when you talk about the space, everybody look at it that it's a, and y'all were saying that it's like a rich person sport. Yeah, most rich people engage in golf. People that have money in most of the business deals in the world are made on golf courses. But we from the inner city, and when we're crying now for things that the youth can do today, person like myself and Shane Gibson and my brothers and them on Blue Hill Golf Course there, I don't know if y'all are aware that that was a golf course before they turned them into softball fields, right?
I didn't know that.
Okay. And we grew up there from we were like 5 years old and with Craig Flowers and them. And when we look at it, it was basically a throwaway because that's right in the inner city, right off Blue Hill Road. I also went to all the primary and all the primary schools and the government schools, and here it was that could have been kept as a golf course because it had lightings on it that you could play golf through the night.
And it was accessible to the average Bahamian.
Right. I mean, even, you know, even the PE classes and mm-hmm. after school, because you could walk from...
Well, caller, to be fair to the golf course that is across the street from the stadium is publicly available. It is, in my opinion, very affordable. It is accessible to the general public.
Do you know that there was this public dump before?
I heard that, yes. Right, I heard that it was a dumping ground.
Yeah, Lizzie, Greg Flowers, we call him Lizzie. You know, he turned it into that, but all of that was where the junior program went away because we all grew up playing golf mm-hmm. because all of Shane and those and my brother and those, they went off to play golf and got their college education. I went off to college too, but I wasn't on a golf scholarship. Now, you know what, your guest, whenever you speak with him again, I hope he would consider remind him what all a golf course does. It's a lot of land, but it's not a waste of land because most homes, when you put them around golf courses, it adds to the value of the properties, right?
Arguably, yes.
Yeah. See, it's a real estate benefit also. Now, because, you know, if you can walk in your backyard, like, and walk and go and play golf every day.
Like an ocean club, I wish.
Man, every golf course.
Wouldn't want to pay the taxes. But...
when there was even a golf course in Coral Harbor.
Yep.
You know what I mean? We used to go out there. So, and look at, it was South Ocean.
I think your point is absolutely valid. Right. There are multiple sides to this argument, caller. Thank you so much for your submission. I also want to stick in and say that you can today... Not just you yourself, caller, but anybody listening, you can today go to the golf course. It is right across the street from the stadium. It is publicly available. I think it's the Providence Golf Association, Bahamas Golf Association.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, anybody can go. You don't have to be rich. You've got $10 in your pocket. You can get in and go swing and learn and practice. They'll give you clubs for free to practice with at the place. And I think it's a great time for you and the family. Good exercise. You do walk because, you know, golf caddy out there. So.
Right. And your topic today.
We're talking with Juana Luther now. I love that you brought that up, caller, because I'm about to ask a question about some of the things happening in Eleuthera revolving around some golf courses. So we'll see. But thank you, caller, for your submission. golf is important. I think everybody should jump in a bandwagon and take advantage of the things. Take advantage of the things.
I don't like golf.
I understand, but this is our course that's available to the public. Go and take advantage of it before they gentrify it one day and, you know, the foreigners take it over and they build a bunch of housing communities that we inaccessible to us. Anyway, so I wanted to talk a bit. So, well, a lot of things have happened in Eleuthera. And this is probably a little controversial, Kieran and Yolanda. So, South Eleuthera, historically, if those of you, anybody listening, if you're from Greencastle or Cape Eleuthera, any of these parts of Eleuthera, used to be a banging place back in the day when, what is it, the Cotton Bay Club?
The old Rock Sound Club.
Yeah, it used Cotton to be open. And that's been closed in the 1980s. Mm-hmm. And since then, the economy of South Eleuthera has absolutely cratered. It's become a more depressed economic area. A lot of students who make it out in terms of going to the University of the Bahamas or going abroad rarely return. However, a lot of things have happened since then. Obviously, we now have the introduction of Mickey Mouse in the southern part of Eleuthera. Sorry, it's just funny
where
to...
Dreams can come
where dreams can come through for people in Nassau getting hired. Am I throwing shade? No, I'm just illuminating reality. And then now there's also the development by the illustrious Frankie Wilson, the nose, into, what is it called, Jack's Bay?
Jack's Bay, yeah.
And there's a myriad of resorts and small, I want to use the word encampments, and there's a reason I use that, of all-exclusive penthouse deals and all these sorts of things, of these small properties and mansions built on them in South Eleuthera. And one of the things that I noticed what was happening is, essentially, it's not the creation and growth of an economy for everybody in South Eleuthera, it's more of the atomization of the economy. Because what I've noticed, just my observation, maybe I'm wrong, I ain't on the ground, you guys are more on the ground than me, the tourism model seems to be micro resorts and developments that hire a handful of people, but it's the same model we have in Nassau, where majority of the profits just basically exit the country. And the actual development, not just on the premises, but the development around it, isn't happening simply because the model that we're using and the way that these things operate, which is just you fly to this resort, you do everything on this premises of this resort, and then you transport yourself off of this island, out of the country. There's no interaction with anything around it. There's no desire to do so. And my question was, a very dark question, is Eleuthera doomed to follow the example of Nassau?
Well, you asked a question that it's so much to unpack. But no, I don't. I wouldn't say Luther is doomed.
Well, South Luther, I should say that.
I would not say South Luther is doomed. I think there's still a lot of potential and a lot of opportunities in South Luther. Let me say that. I'm always an optimistic person. Like you said, there's a number of developments happening. You have, you know, the Jack's Bay project. You know, Disney's having that project at Lighthouse Point. You also have Cotton Bay is doing that project. My understanding, it's supposed to be a Ritz-Carlton Reserve. So you have a number of those developments happening.
Which
there's
one
also
is the
some
one across from Savannah Sound that they're developing?
Across from Savannah Sound.
It's like a, it's, I don't know. It's like on a, on the other side. Like you could stand by the one side and you could look over and you see like all the. The last time I was there, I was there last year, and they were digging like a.
Oh, Windermere Island?
Windermere Island, maybe you're talking about?
It. Yeah.
Not sure.
A lot of
but
developments happening over there.
You got the marina they're trying to do in Governor's Harbor. There's another.
Marina in Cape Eleuthera exists.
Yep, Cape Eleuthera's development. You have another one that's trying to happen at Winding Bay. So it's a number of developments happening. I think one of the big things is, and you talked about Nassau persons getting jobs. I think one of the biggest challenges with all this development is going to be
Training people.
Training. How are you gonna find?
That's where you all come in. But yeah,
that's another conversation. But
you have to do it.
Definitely, I would say it's the development of the people on the island.
Yep.
To be able to take advantage of these opportunities. But what you're seeing is the window is closing so fast that at the end of the day, these resorts, these organizations, they want people in there and they want it fast because they want their place open and they want that. Mm-hmm. They want to be able to, I guess, turn in the profits, for example. But what I think the focus needs to be is how do we get Eleutherans ready to take advantage of these opportunities? One, from from the just human capital side of it. When we talk about the infrastructural side of it, that's a whole other conversation. Issues of power, water, the telecommunications. I think part of it is, you know, some of these responsibilities of developing some of these facilities may need to be put on some of those developers to some extent. You also have issues of, well, we talked about food security. That's another big area that we're in. And I think there's a lot of opportunity there.
So I wanted to ask you a question about that. Is it so you do like a farmer's market?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Is that like every Saturday?
We used to do it once a month. We just starting back up with it. We got our first farmer's market this month again.
Is that for Bahamians or is most of the food that you produce is to get shipped to Nassau?
Well, we don't ship to Nassau yet, but our farmer's market are generally people on Eleuthera who are farms. And we welcome everybody to the farm.
Okay, awesome. That's good.
So, Don.
No, I'm just talking about the infrastructure. Yolanda, you have something?
Yeah. So, we have human capital issues. We have the infrastructure challenges that come with that. My other big challenge I see is transportation. Oh, how are people going to get to these places? And so, do I think, Don, to your point, it's doomed? No. I see opportunity for entrepreneurship. I see opportunity on the training side. I see opportunity on the food security side. People need to eat. There's opportunity on the transportation side. So there's a lot of opportunities for entrepreneurs to be developed in this space. For employment, opportunities for people who want to do food security stuff as well, like what we're doing. But I think these issues are definitely things that have to be addressed if for us not to be doomed, if that's the point you're trying to
something make. The point that I talk about, right, is when we went to Eleuthera, something I noticed, it was difficult in Governor's Harbor to find fresh fruits and vegetables.
Mm-hmm.
And I literally kept saying, because I know you, I was like, why they just don't go down by the place and get the fruits and vegetables by Wanalucho?
Which is why...
Understood. I thought it was a challenge unique to Eleuthera, but I found out later on it's across the entirety of the Fahmy Islands. Right. But something I thought about consistently is you talk about transportation. A lot of people don't have cars, and they try, if they can, to work wherever they can work, but usually they're trapped within their communities if they can't catch a ride.
Because
a lot of people don't have cars. And I've wondered for years, why don't we have proper public transportation? Well, Nassau seems to be a dumpster fire that ain't changing, so give up on that. But at least in Eleuthera, where it's developing, it needs a centralized bus system, not like the garbage we have in Nassau.
No, but this is a good opportunity for the government. In islands that are growing, like Eleuthera, Abaco, Bimini, like the islands that are like really growing, they definitely need more... of that.
There was talks about a busing system that was being established in Eleuthera. Now, I'm not sure exactly what happened to it, to be honest with you. But I agree with you wholeheartedly on everything you're saying. I think one of the challenges what Fahmy Islands face is, and this is like for-profit companies as well, and this is where the challenge is. If a lot of private sector entities don't see a profit generation opportunity where they can make money that's worth their investment, they're not going to take that chance. That's why when you look at the ambulance and the fire trucks that we did, we had to take that on in the beginning because it's a basic necessity. Some people may not saw the profit value there because the development wasn't there yet. But what you're seeing now is with all this development happening, you got new clinics on the island. You got Bahamas Wellness there now. You got Family Medicine there now. You got... Yeah. You know,
Doctors Hospital doing this up,
and they're trying. Doctors Hospital is trying to get that 1 point. So now that these opportunities are opening up, you see people moving into space. But for us, we had to take on those risks. We had to take on those challenges because if we didn't do it,
there would be nothing.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's the reality of it.
So nonprofit and government, like I feel like that's good from that end, but for something like transportation. I think the government should be a little bit more, and I know we have a deficit, right?
But
a big one.
Yeah. But I mean, I think something like that in a growing economy like Eleuther, that would help so many people, especially as we've seen the uptick in accidents over the last couple of years. And most of these people are people catching rides.
I just wrote an article on that.
Yeah. So a lot of people are catching rides. They can catch the bus now and they can be safe. So that is something I think the government and
well, it also cuts costs.
The government tried to do like a bus pilot program. How many times in Nassau? They could try to do it in Eleuther. It's way smaller and it'll probably be more successful.
There's three things we can't do in this country because we just seem to lack the ability to do it. One, amend the constitution. Two, have a unified bus system in Nassau. Three, like not have a deficit. These three things just elude us. That's just incapable of accomplishing them. But anyway, enough about the dumpster fire that's Nassau. The reason I bring this up to is when we talk about the development is my observation of Eleuther is it's very different in terms of its tourism model compared to most islands.
It is.
Eleuther has a gigantic, in comparison, second home market of foreign individuals who dump a lot of money into investment in their own properties and property taxes on the island of Eleuther to build second homes. You have entire communities of people. Like we stayed at a place, I think it was called the German.
That was the German town.
Yeah, German town, where a bunch of Germans bought a couple acres of land and then developed it into their own community. Several have sold and some are still there.
Some are abandoned.
Yes. And it's like, I haven't seen a duplication of that really in New Providence at all. So obviously the way in which Eleuther is developing is on a slightly different path. But now that there's a lot more development happening, a lot more investment, it's starting to seem to me like we're duplicating some of the same mistakes of New Providence.
But to your point, I don't think that is unique to Eleuther.
Really?
I think you have a lot of persons with that kind of wealth in other family islands.
Oh, yes.
But
Eleuther is the one that seems to actually have a growing population. Most of the family islands.
No. I feel like Abaco is already there. Because
its population shrank.
Abaco was the only island that was turning a surplus before.
No, I agree.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Abaco, then Dorian like, and
they, Abaco on a whole different. They doing something different.
Even Exuma now is picking up.
Well, yeah, Exuma too.
It's too late.
It's a matter
to buy into Exuma now.
How do you create access, Dawn?
Yeah.
How do you connect these persons with wealth to local persons in the community and to care about causes in these communities? And it all boils down to trust. How do you bridge that gap? And I think that's one thing that one Eleuther was able to do in the beginning, especially in the beginning, being able to get persons who've been coming there for years, who care about the community,
to
who want to see it developed, to give back to it. And there was always this sense of care to want to help.
I feel like NGOs are like that too, because Brief is similar, right?
Yep.
But it's like, how do you ensure that, like, with that type of thing you're developing? So the NGOs are great. What they're doing is good.
Right.
That is what NGOs need. And I think a lot of more people should follow that example. If you're coming to this country, most of them are not from here. They're foreigners. They're coming in. Yep. They're being a part of these communities. Donate, support, help, assist, get behind a lot of these NGOs that are doing good things for the community, 100%. But when you talk about like individuals who live in the community, how do you, I don't want to say ensure, but what seems to be happening, right, is, you know, you have, like what Dawn was saying, it looks like a duplication of Nassau because it's just, you're relying on trickle down. That's fine for an NGO to secure money from, places.
Yeah.
But when you look at individual citizens, when a multimillionaire builds a super big mega development, marina and these fancy homes, golf course, that's their money, right?
Yep.
And that's them doing stuff. When they hire Bahamians, and most of the Bahamians in Eleuther will be, most of them don't have degrees. So they're probably going to just be hired to do lower work, right? Where they won't be able to make money. They're not going to be able to climb the ladder because a lot of those positions require people with degrees, et cetera. And so they're going to bring in a lot of foreign laborers who will be collecting those big, but Nassau still don't have the capacity. If we're talking about if these things being duplicated on all these family islands, it's still a system where
the wealthy people buy up
the wealth concentrates in the opposite direction of Bahamians, basically.
Away from Bahamians, not
go, Yolanda. Bahamians. Sorry.
That it, and how do you make sure that does not happen?
I'm not allowed to that. Yeah, go ahead, Yolanda.
I was going to say to Crystal's point too. I think it takes vision and innovation and diversification of tourism. We have in terms of airlift, the second busiest airport in the Bahamas. Mm-hmm. All of those tourists are not going to contain spaces. At last year's Business Outlook in Eleuthera, I think it was the Bahamas Out Island and Promotions Board that stated one of the top three complaints by tourists that visit is that there's not enough for them to do once they get on the island. And if you have your tourists that are saying that, you know, they would spend money if there was more for them to engage with, especially if it was based in culture. We also have ecotourism that's undertapped here. We have a large boating and yachting community, especially post-Dorian. A lot of the boaters that would have traditionally gone into Abaco have ventured to Eleuthera and either now come to Eleuthera or spread their time between both islands. So there's been a whole lot of growth. There needs to be the vision to see where the opportunities exist to fill gaps and fill needs for the boating community, for those that are looking for entertainment and for cultural experiences and immersion experience, for more nature-based tours like bird watching, which we also facilitate on our property. So I feel like Eleuthera is a gold mine. We do have the bigger problems of infrastructural gaps and shortages, like Kiran pointed to, that will have to be addressed. We do have the transportation issue, which also affects tourism and impedes guests being able to move along the length of 110-mile island to support businesses. But with ingenuity and with being able to create entrepreneurship opportunities and also to provide the link to funding, I feel that we can really grow that sector in tourism and in entrepreneurship. And many people can become very wealthy if they just have the vision and have the plan to maximize on the opportunities that exist currently in Eleuthera and are also coming on stream.
It also, you know, the one thing that we haven't talked about as well, and Yolanda, you have a good point, is it also is a shift in the it's a cultural shift in our mindsets of what we want as a people and what we're going to put in to make it happen. And what I mean by that is, you know, in many instances, people have to also want that for themselves. How do you get persons, for example, since this does a family, right? They want to put food on their table. There's somebody who doesn't have a job, right? They don't have a job. They have three kids, a family home. How do you get them? And this is, I think, where we have to come in as organizations to really help change the mindset. How do you get somebody to say, hey, I need a job now to put food on the table right now for my family? Home ownership, that song's so far away from me. I cannot relate to that because I need to put food on the table for my family right now. How do you get persons to not think just about the short
survival, basically.
Exactly. So we have to get at some point, and it's a hard thing because a lot of people face these challenges, and it's a reality for them. How do we translate those immediate issues and get them to see beyond that long-term point? And I think the only way we have to do that is you have to get people out of survival mode. Once they get out of survival mode, then there's that next step of, okay, what more do you want? So that entrepreneurship seems out of reach for some people. Like that's something that... They don't have the capital. It just don't, in some instances, feel realistic for them. Yes. And not everybody is willing to take on that risk and challenge and headache and administrative bureaucracy to get it done.
Yeah.
So...
you have to do my business license now, but yes, but valid.
But these are the realities of when we talk about wanting more for Bohemians and wanting more for ourselves.
But sorry.
Go ahead.
Go ahead, Crystal. Not just that. I agree with your point. But So even if he's not like I don't have the capital. I don't have the I have to focus on my family. I have all these other things to deal with. He could say that I want a job, but where does he go to find a job with no
like no education, right? Like no what do you call it? No, like let's say you
training skills,
training. Yeah, skills yeah, development.
Like he needs skills development and training. Yes, good. But he should be able to say, okay, I don't want to be an entrepreneur, but I want to find a job where I will get paid a livable wage, like something I could. So for those who don't want to be entrepreneurs, where can they go to work? Like, where are the opportunities where they can go to work and they could say, I know at the end of the day, I don't have to work 3 and 4 jobs just to get a decent salary, and I can live and take care of my family and have a healthy life.
I'll give you an example of one of the ways that we looked at doing that, right? We recognize that we have a program called a Learn and Earn program that we started years ago. We recognize that if somebody has to decide whether or not they put food on their table and get training, the reality of it is they're always going to go for that job opportunity, right? Mm-hmm. So we said, hey, we have to create something that will get more people to buy into it. And what we did is we had a campus that we were developing, brought a group of people from these different communities and say, hey, we will give you training, but we will also pay you as part of this training program, an apprenticeship program. But with this training, you're going to be able to get hands-on experience. You're going to help. When you look at our hotel, our training hotel that we have, all of the furniture are done by students. Yes. They got paid to do that. So they learned a skill. They got some experience. They were able to get a wage for their families, mm-hmm. and they were able to put that on their resume to get employment opportunities elsewhere, or even some of them, a lot of them actually came on and retained the staff at the foundation. Mm-hmm. But at some point, and this is one of the things we were working through, is, okay, it's okay. When we see some of our staff members, they go off and some of them have already started their own businesses. They've gone on to new opportunities. Some people see that as a bad thing. Oh, some people are leaving. No, it's a good thing. Mm-hmm. If somebody can leave and get an entrepreneurship opportunity to go and do their own business or have an opportunity to get a place of employment I'll give you an example. You had a guy, I'll make this short, Dawn, because I know you pressed for time. But you had a guy, he came to our program. He did an electrical course. He was on staff with us for several years. Got started and started his own electrical business. And he went on, he started doing that on his own. It was a side business for him and it became something great. He left. It wasn't a bad thing.
It's good. So
it was good. But some people would say, hey, he left. Oh my God, the world is over. No, the world is not over.
That's a wonderful thing that he did.
And we need to train more people to come into the system and move out to grow inside the economy. I think that's one of the approaches we have to take.
Yolanda, you had something to say?
And I would thank you, Juan. Really, that's the pathway that we're creating through CTR, our Center for Training and Innovation, which is powered by Wanalutra, is the opportunity for these students, especially those that are falling through the cracks in high school and not graduating, being able to get technical trades and skills under their belt, like Kiwan says, to first meet that need of being able to provide for themselves and then create a pathway to entrepreneurship should they wish to take that route. But I'll tell you, people in Eleuthera are very industrious and they're not afraid of entrepreneurship and starting businesses. I think I would venture to say probably 20% of the population, maybe more, has at least one side hustle.
Yeah.
At least.
I like the sound of that in terms of, and it'll only get better, in my opinion, in terms of opportunity as the population continues to grow. And like I said, I find Eleuthera to be a very remarkable place, because when I looked at the preliminary census data, almost every single family island has had a decrease in population. Eleuthera is the only place that's remained. The stats will say static. But when you look at the fact that the population has actually grown and the Eleuthera's percentage has not decreased, it actually means that Eleuthera's population has also grown with the growth of our actual national population, which is, I dare say, probably the only island that's actually successfully done that.
That's why we need more people to come home to Eleuthera.
Every island has lost people. Abaco has lost people.
We've been talking about a campaign to get more people to come back to the farm islands.
Oh, yeah, so.
It needs to be some people who are willing to go the hard road, you know, and help build what we want to see. It's always a single, this isn't there. That isn't there. Yeah. We have to build it. Yeah. We have to create it. Yeah. we are the only ones who are going to solve that problem.
I like that you say that. It's this wonderful place. If you ever went to Orlando and you want to drive on International Drive, it's this whole area called Dr. Phillips. Right? It's very weird to me. And then I went and read the history on it. It was literally a dude who's a doctor who developed an entire area of Orlando because they didn't have any of those things. But he did. Now, of course, you need capital to do these things.
Yeah.
But if you don't try to do it, who's actually going to do it? So I'm gonna borrow this right here. If not you, then who? If not now, then when?
Yeah.
When are you going to actually do it?
Somebody will build it and then we'll come. No. We need to come build it. We need to build the place that we want to see.
Agreed. Yeah. Agreed. Yeah. Kiro, we got to do this again. We got to do this more often. Yeah. I actually want to make this a, if we can, once a month thing.
Yeah.
If we can, y'all come in and chime in on some stuff because y'all doing some good stuff.
Yeah.
And y'all do something. Last I checked now, y'all did something that is very unheard of in this country. Mm. Y'all actually produce some data.
Check our website. Our audited financial statements are there. Our impact reports are there. We are very transparent as an organization. We'll get used to it.
But the government is.
Y'all need to do some courses for the government for a lot of these departments. That's what y'all need to do.
You know, the irony of her saying this is she has no idea.
Y'all need to do some.
It's almost like we have a government and public. Anyway,
it's a hard road. I'll say that this is not easy.
Just plenty part old man.
A lot of things should be public. You know. And that's why we don't remember the caller. That's why we don't have a lot of statistics. The guy was asking, you know, where do you go to find all this data and statistics? We should have.
We don't pump out enough data.
We
in this country.
Are missing on some of those UN lists. You know,
some all, just about all. The data is usually incomplete. We're out of time, unfortunately. Any final words, Yolanda and Kiron?
I agree, Don and Crystal. Thank you for having us. We must come back. We haven't even begun to scratch the surface of, you know, exactly what One Eleuthera does, our social enterprises, and how this model can be replicated throughout the Bahamas and in, of course, New Providence, where we need help.
Straight
to the point, we need help in New Providence. So we definitely welcome that opportunity to come back and get a little deeper into things. But thank you for having us.
Yeah, and if you want to find out more information about what we're doing, you can go to www.oneeleuthera.org, and you can find some of that information we talked about. And yes, we have data. It's right on our website. And just want to say thank you for having us on the show. Excited about that. I'd love to find out, and I think a lot of people are doing good work. It's just we need to tell the story a little bit more because it gets hidden behind all the other stuff that's happening in Nassau. Yes. But I think you have a platform that can get a lot more persons to tell their stories on the good work that they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So I appreciate that, and I hope we could talk more about that.
Yes, I also want to end on a positive note. It's not related to much of what we've just been talking about, but congratulations to it skipped my mind just now. Lyford Key International School for winning Junior Junkanoo. Yes, Junior Junkanoo was this week, and congratulations to all of the kids who participated in Junior Junkanoo. I sat down and I watched a parade, and it was beautiful. And those kids, the ideas that they came up with, beautiful. The costumes, beautiful. The creativity, the choreography. You would think that, you know, they're little kids, so they just would be jumping around.
No.
They were very organized. Their outfits, their costumes were very detailed. It was just beautiful. They look like they could compete with the big boys. They're really, 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 really good. So congratulations to everyone. That was just that uplifted me this week. That was just the best.
Money
thing
tends to do that. Anyway, so we're out of time. Unfortunately, I hope if I have a child, they can get a scholarship to go to Life Again International for joining Junior Junkanoo. I really hope so. We should make this a sport, an international sport. Make it bigger than it actually is right now. Anyway, we're out of time. Unfortunately, please stay tuned next week. We have a very, very controversial show. Let's see if we can pull it off. It's going to be great. But many hands build a home, many hearts build a school, but it takes many engaged Bahamians like me, you, Kiro, and everybody else to build the Bahamas. Be good, Bahamas.
There it is. Wait. Find what you love and let it kill you. Sharpen the pressure, thinking diamond.